Vietnam is more developed, but CLM is less developed. And so it's the duty of existing member to help. So what our objective is to strengthen our position in the regions to solve transitional problems of the region. Because our border is very close to a CLMV. So any of that problem is our problem. Right. I mean, Rohingya problems in Myanmar is our problem because they cross the border and we have to set up a camp, taking care of them, and human trafficking causing a lot of problems to our seafood industry. And Rohingya is a supply of human trafficking industry, actually. So we have to help them at the origin of the problems. So that's why we have to do transitional development, regional development actions. So we also want to have bargaining power, and we help them to get some bargaining powers. And it's mutual benefits, of course. It's economic, industrial cooperation has opened up opportunities for greater trade and investment. I will go through that later. This is CLMV that we taking active roles in helping them develop various things like infrastructure and education, for example. So this is ASEAN Vision 2020, promoting equitable economic development to reduce poverty, social economic disparities in the region. That's the key. Okay. So what I try to present is just some outline of what have been done in the regions. And so for the government itself, for the Thai government itself, I talk about two parts, which is infrastructure development and education assistance. Okay. So infrastructure development, mainly transportation infrastructure and energy infrastructure. So for example, this one was built like nearly 10 years ago, and it's linking between the Thai city, the Thai province, opposite Vientiane. Vientiane is the capital of Laos. And so we link, before Chinese build high-speed train, we do this. It's not high-speed train, but we do a linking between Vientiane to Bangkok by train. So we cross the bridge, just over 20 kilometers cross the bridge. This station is outside, further outside of Vientiane. So this is the project we have done. It accommodated about 2.5 to 3,000 passengers per day, linking between Nong Khai, which is Thai province, to Thanh Lai, which is a suburb of Vientiane. It's further away from Vientiane. Okay. This is some infrastructure project. This is some energy projects. I mean, of course, when you are less developed, and when you are developing, your supply of electricity would not be enough. So Vietnam, for example, is growing very fast, very strong, and it's an investment opportunity as well for us to invest. So this part is Quang Tri power stations in Vietnam. And phase one, we build a 1,200 megawatt, two of them, coal power plant by electricity generating authority of Thailand. It's 99% owned by the government. And phase two already got the license by Korean Western Power. So this is kind of investment that we're trying to help and trying to benefit as well at the same time. These are some examples of what we have done in Laos. Especially the hydropower dam in Laos. We are a major buyer of electricity from Laos. Laos, they want to position themselves as a battery of ASEAN, for example. So we have helped them build, for example, Nam Nung 1, I can't use the pointer anyway. So Nam Nung 1 was built 1971, a long time ago. But we helped them build it, and Thai government and Thai state-owned enterprise, as well as Thai private sector, take part of it and own tell about electricity power from hydropower in Laos. So that's one. Chaiyaburi Dam is a problem that happened early this year. But yes, it's a cooperation between Thai companies and Korean companies as well, and Laotian government. That's a problem as well because of the leakage of the dam. Okay. Another one. Why? Before that, why we build a lot of dam in Laos? No, we just don't build dam because we want to build dam. It's because the cost of electricity in Thailand is high, and we don't have any new locations for building hydropower dam in Thailand. So Laos is, there's a huhuge part of Laos that the Mekong River passed through, and it's an opportunity for us to build dam there to generate electricity for Thai consumption as well, for sharing. And Thai consumption means we pay Laotian government for the electricity we generate there. So it's a two-way benefit, it's mutual benefits. They got the revenue, we got the electricity. We build for them as well. So that's a key. Another one is very interesting. Is infrastructure projects. We help them participate or taking active role in terms of building a bridge across between Thai and Laos. We call it Thai-Lao Foreign Friendship Bridge. So since the first one was built like 20 years ago, more than 20 years ago, it's been linking between Nong Khai and Vinh Chang. So after that, we keep building more and more. The second one between Mukdahan and Sawannakhet. Mukdahan, Sawannakhet, linking to Da Nang. It's a direct line linking to Da Nang here. Up here. Sorry, pointer doesn't work on the screen. Okay. So it's linking between Mukdahan, crossing to Sawannakhet, and then there's a road direct to Da Nang. So is the closest sea access or access to sea transport for northeastern part of Thailand to Da Nang, especially for those far further away on the northeastern part of Thailand. So that's the benefit we have. So this is another one linking between Nakhon Phnom to Khammon. Yeah, it's the name of the province in Laos called Khammon. Yeah. And the fourth one is linking between Chiang Rai up north. Chiang Rai is up north and Hua Sai. And the fifth one is building, is linking between Bung Kan and Pak Seng. So we are building that. And you know, because of the bridge, we are having a cross-border trade with Laos, a lot of cross-border trade. We are one of the major exporters to Laos for various consumer products. Many factories in Thailand can export to Laos. It's closer to use this bridge than coming from China as well. So this kind of thing, and it's promote tourism as well. So it's a benefit, mutual benefits. When you're talking about Thailand development aid, I mean, you will say we don't have much money. So whatever project we do, we tend to think that it would in return benefit us somehow. So most of these as an example like this, the electricity generations through hydropower, the bridge linking commerce and tourism between two countries. And also this one is another one called, I'm sure you know about it, is Da Voi port in Myanmar. It's going nowhere, but it's a strategic thinking of Thai government that they don't want to build this project was initiated like 10 years ago when the Democrat Party was in government, and the key many area that suitable for building port in Thailand is also very strategic in terms of tourism industry. So we don't want to, instead of tourism industry, promoting for tourism industry, we build a commercial port, which industrial port, which is, it will substitute the tourism industry, which we think is may not be right decision. So we build a port in, we try to build a port in Myanmar instead. And it, you can see here, it directly linked to Bangkok within 3 hours. If we build waterway, it's just 3 hours to Darwin, which is very close, very, very close. 3 hours is like you take from Bangkok to the eastern port, 2 hours as well, to Lam Chabang. It's about 1.5 hours, 2 hours. So Darwin is not that far. It's very close to Bangkok. And it links between the western part, linking between ocean, Indian Oceans to Pacific Oceans. Yeah, with that, it's very strategic. But the problem is we need international partner, we have not got it. The Japanese we want, but they still thinking about it because they have their own port in Yangon as well. Chinese, they have their own port near Yangon as well. So we kind of struggle to get enough investment on that project. But it's strategic, it's linking between Indian Ocean to Bangkok, to Pacific Ocean, to the eastern port, and can link, go to Vietnam as well, the link. Okay, the second part is education development. I kind of talked to it. So Thailand worked closely with Southeast Asian Minister of Education Organization, which is CMEO, to initiate many education development projects to raise awareness of ASEAN, such as spirits of ASEAN school, ASEAN focus school, ASEAN youth caring and sharing program, and ASEAN manuals. Okay, so this is some examples what we provide expert training. This is the help between Bank of Thailand and Bank of Laos, PDR. In 2014, we organized a training program. Actually, this training program has happened for like 20 years. And this one, the recent one, is 2014. We have helped them to gain expertise. So we help building technical school, which is a vocational school. It's a technical college, basically. It's called Kampong Chua Tian High School, located in Kampong Chong. This is 15 years ago. And also we, Thailand International Cooperation, we have Thailand International Cooperation Agency called TIGA, a focal agency under the Ministry of Foreign Affairs of Thailand. It's one of Thai organizations continually providing a large number of educational projects, including scholarships, volunteer expertise, and annual international training costs for CLMV, especially, because we're helping them. And we will see more and more involvement from Thai private sector as well, because of the fact that they are key investor. CP Group is the largest food producer in ASEAN, I guess. They're number one in for chicken producer in Vietnam, in Indonesia, in Thailand. They're growing their business in Laos, in Philippines, and so on, so on. SCG is Siam Cement Group is one of the oldest construction material manufacturer in ASEAN, like 120 years already. So it has operation in Philippines, has operations in Vietnam, has operation all over the place. It's building 20 billion petrochemical complex in Vietnam as well. So they building positions in various places. PTT, of course, is national company, is the largest company in Thailand, is the energy company. It has petrostration all over in CLMV. So they are private sector, is one of the important Thai contemporaries in the regions. So they provide a lot of help. They provide, basically it's a CSR project, but CSR project that help the local community, CSR project that help building education infrastructure, scholarship. For example, SCT providing scholarship to ASEAN students. It's called Dream Scholarship Program. And they are providing that. I talked to SCTs when I visit them in Vietnam, and they kind of helping to promote local staff. They see that in the future there will be an ASEAN company and they will have executive roles appointed by locals, ASEAN countries, citizens, for example, in Vietnam, for example, in Philippines. And also PTT, they organize a program called CIOLA. This is stimulating interventions, optimizing and service for children. So PTT EP, PTT Explorations, investing a lot of money in donations in various countries in the region. So they provide education development for the local communities. So that's the role of Thai private sector. You can say it's a CSR, but CSR in some extent is development as well. So in summary, Thai government focus on infrastructure and education. Why infrastructure? Because it's expand our trade and investment opportunities in the regions. So we just don't build bridge just to build bridge. We build bridge to it. Facilitate trade and tourism and investment opportunities in the regions. We help in terms of education because we need better workforce. We work together with them. A lot of their workforce coming to Thailand to work, so that's the benefits as well. And Thai private sector engage more broadly on development issue. They do various things, many concerning their CSR, their image, but it's more focused on the area or region or country that they invest. And future trends, I think we will see, for example, Chayaburi Dam and this one, and Quang Tri Power Station. We see more and more involvement between Thai private sector, Thai government, and regional, with global and regional players for new development projects. We cannot go alone. We think it better to have global and regional players, and so we are looking, and in various projects we partner with Korea as well. So like maybe Korea is an important political and more neutral partner, politically more neutral partner. It's not like China, it's not like US and Japan. You have a liberal order attached to it. So we're looking for something that more politically neutral. And we will observe more active role by private sector from Thailand. As they step up their investment in Xiaomi, we will see more and more of them development projects in the region as well. So that's
thank you very much, Kwon. So Kwon is giving us updates on Thailand's initiative in terms of improving the physical infrastructure, which in the process helps enhance physical, not just physical connectivity, but also people-to-people connectivity. And he also presented the educational initiatives of Thailand. But one good thing that I learned about this presentation is the important role of the private sector. And I think that's something that we missed in yesterday's presentation. Because really to advance a country's development goals, there has to be close collaboration among different stakeholders, among different development actors, not just government, but also private sector and civil society. Our next presenter, friends, will present about development cooperation through the ASEAN regional economic integration. So from sort of a social aspect. Yes, economic aspect. This time, Andrew will tell us about how the ASEAN is in different different countries, member countries in the ASEAN are trying to advance its, in particular, the ASEAN economic blueprint. So let me give you brief information about Andrew. He is an associate professor and senior research fellow at the Institute of Malaysian and International Studies, the National University of Malaysia, and graduated first class. conference. I now give you Dr. Andrew Kang Jian.
Thank you, and I'm glad to listen to all of you. People sound more interesting than it is. Good morning, everyone. I have a confession to make. When I received the email from Kaidak, I did not read the email properly. I thought that I was a discussant. I didn't read properly the email until the second email, and I said, oh, actually, I have to write a paper. So this paper was put, not in a hurry, with lots of thoughts, through my engagement this year with the Ministry of International Trade Malaysia, with United Nations, with UNTAC, with EREA as well. So it's a lame excuse for a bad presentation, but either that or you can blame yesterday's set if we are there drank. Okay. First of all, I would like to thank the organizers, KAIDAC, Korean Foundation, and of course PIDS. And most importantly, I would like to thank Dr. Pham from Vietnam yesterday for starting the ball rolling on ASEAN. I hope you have used up all the difficult questions on him, so that I know you are spared from all those difficult questions. Anyway, yesterday, Mr. Yulio, okay, mentioned that development cooperation can be anything under the sun. That's what he mentioned. In his presentation. So I would like to avoid that and try to actually scope development cooperation into three major purposes. This is taken from Severino and Ray. Okay, so bear with me for a while just to go through the list. It says that development cooperation should at least ensure universal basic standards of social protection. Second, it should close the gap on living standards among countries. And third, supporting the efforts of developing countries in actively participating in provision of public goods. So with that in mind, actually, many Asian ASEAN, many ASEAN integration objectives actually set to achieve this task. So then the activities within ASEAN also aim to support national or international development priorities. It says that it should not be profit-driven, but I digress. I'll say that it should be mutual profit-driven. Okay, and the most important thing is somewhat discriminate in favor of developing countries. This is taken from Alonso and Glennie. Okay, but as Dr. Lim yesterday asked, okay, how can it be done? And is there a catch? So before we go into details, I would just like to again scope or reiterate what Dr. Pham said. Development cooperation can come in many shapes and sizes or many definitions. One of it we have discussed a lot is on ODA. Of course, there are challenges and criticisms, and there are pros and cons in it. Another way is through capacity building. Sorry, I didn't put it on my slide. And by my paper, I would like to discuss more on policy change, cooperation through policy change, where there is a form where we can actually level the playing field for developing countries. And developed countries can actually change the rules as a form of support to accommodate poor countries in market-related activities. So the paper will mostly focus on the economic perspective, or as Dr. Huang yesterday mentioned, that it is market principle. Okay, I'll just go on. All right, ASEAN. So to actually understand whether ASEAN is can actually help in terms of development cooperation, we can just go back to the 1965 Bangkok Declaration. In the seventh aim, ASEAN said that it is created to maintain close and beneficial cooperation with existing international and regional organizations with similar purposes and aims, and explore for even closer cooperation among themselves. So it's actually a part of, it's a development cooperation sort of organization that's been set up. But then again, throughout the years, okay, there are many sort of market-led initiatives like AFTA, AFAS, and AIA, and of course the formation of ASEAN Economic Community. In my presentation, I will first explain some of the achievements. Okay, you can question whether it's effective or not, but I will explain some of the sunny side of the story, you know. But on the second half, I will just say that there's more than meets the eyes, you know. All these achievements, sort of quote unquote, of ASEAN, you know, if we read between the lines, there are actually some cause of concerns, and some issues of concerns. Okay, ASEAN played a key development cooperation role in Asia or in the global markets by creating economic cooperation between its member states, and you know, and like what Dr. Pang said yesterday, it actually connects its member state with other countries like Korea, China, through the ASEAN Plus 3 initiative. So the data actually shows, okay, like for example, ASEAN Plus 3, is there a So if you look at, you know, the ASEAN Plus 3 initiative, a large portion of agricultural raw material, almost 50% of total ASEAN trade is actually with countries like Korea, China, and Japan. And of course, the notion of liberalization, cooperation, and community building has been the core of ASEAN. Of ASEAN development, okay.